pin, rocking all that golden red. The banners hung, the boys all got their rings. The last one took us 50 years, but we're loaded up. The gang's all here, and that trophy is staying right here in KC. This ain't no other season here in Chiefs Kingdom. So run it back for the boys from 69, back for the fans on 12 and Pine. Run it back to back and raise it high. We ain't here to attempt the camp, ain't no time for a victory lap. No, we came to run it back. Yeah, try to keep up if you dare. Just listen for the banging of the drum. You blinked and we just scored. And even if we spot you 24, look out for Kansas City, here we come. We'll leave you on your knees saying hail to the Chiefs. So run it back for the boys from 69, back for the fans on 12 and Vine. Run it back to back and raise it high. We ain't here to attempt the camp, ain't no time for a victory lap. No, we came to run it back.
What a goal! What a goal!
Back for Lamar, back for Coach Reed, run one back for old DT, run it back for Lombardi number three. So run it.
Hello and welcome into Alex Lou's podcast. This is a brand new podcast that I'm starting completely on my own. I'm new to this. I have recorded a podcast in the past with a friend, but this time I'm going solo. My name is Alex Lou. This is the first session I'm recording on this podcast. And originally my goal for this podcast was to focus on Kansas City sports. I'm a Kansas City native, and you know, I wanted to focus my podcast on me being a Kansas City sports fan and everything that's going on with the Chiefs and the Royals, as well as Kansas State, K-State football and basketball. I'm starting this podcast in this very first session at a very unique time, as the Chiefs are getting ready, just days away now, from their second straight Super Bowl. After last year's Super Bowl win over the 49ers, you know, I was just ecstatic. I couldn't believe it. It was something that I dreamed of for my entire life. and so for months, even after the win, even after the parade, it was surreal for me. Growing up a Chiefs fan, going through years of heartache. I'll get into this a little bit more, but you know, as the Chiefs and as the Chiefs fans, as Kansas City as a town is looking forward to Super Bowl this Sunday, all of Chiefs Kingdom getting ready for the big day. You know, a lot of those jitters are coming up from last year, and that goal in mind of running it back is still very much alive. So there's a lot that I'm going to go into in this first session, and I'm probably going to ramble quite a bit because this is the first session I'm recording. I don't really have much structure. I'm just kind of going with the flow, just on the fly, just speaking my mind. So first and foremost, I'm going to give a brief introduction to myself and really expanding on why I'm doing this podcast and kind of go into what this podcast is going to be about and what it's probably going to develop into, as I don't really fully know what it's going to be about as I continue going forward. But I wanted to get this first session out in particular before the Super Bowl. I had really been trying to record my first couple of sessions to go along with this season and the playoff run of 2020 into 2021. But the timing just didn't work out until now. So let's go ahead and get started. Again, my name is Alex Liu. This is my podcast. I really haven't even come up with a name for it yet, but I'm sure that will come. I thought about either Alex Liu's podcast or, Alex Liu's KC Sports podcast, or maybe something along the lines of ALU 2 Productions podcast. ALU 2 Productions is my video production / graphic design, photography, creative sort of alias that I have a personal hobby outside of work in my personal life, where I enjoy making videos, producing videos, everything from shooting, editing, producing videos that I put out on YouTube and Instagram. This podcast is going to be on my YouTube channel. I'm going to make a separate playlist to air this podcast. I also enjoy graphic design and some photography. I'm trying to get better in both of those areas. So it all falls under the umbrella, the overarching umbrella of ALU 2 Productions, just as a side personal hobby for myself. So anyway, let's go ahead and dive into this. So let's talk Chiefs. First and foremost, again, my name is Alex Liu, and I was born in Kansas City. I'm a Kansas City native. I really did not grow up in Kansas City, but I was born in Overland Park, Kansas, and I lived in Kansas City for the first 3 to 3.5 years of my life with my parents. And then my family and I moved to the East Coast just before I turned 4 years old. And I've pretty much really grown up on the East Coast between Northern Virginia and the suburbs of Philadelphia with my brother and sister. My brother and sister both were born in Virginia, but they essentially grew up in Philadelphia. But despite all that, I've really stuck with Kansas City and especially the Chiefs. The Chiefs have really been the first love of my life since I was probably about 2 or 3 years old, having just brief, almost real distant memories, like just vague images of the Chiefs logo and the colors, the red and yellow. When I was real little, for Christmas, probably my second or third Christmas, I got one of those kids football uniforms, the little toy set. So it came with a little plastic Chiefs helmet that I could actually put on, and the jersey, the pants. I got a little cotton stuffed football for Christmas 1 year, and I remember watching football on TV when I was real little, and I just fell in love with the game and fell in love with the Chiefs. Even when the Chiefs were bad back in the day when I was growing up, I just loved football and I loved the Chiefs, even if I didn't, know really much about the players or the team or really the history, understand the game fully. But it's always been a love since I was real, real little. I'm also a big Royals and K-State football and basketball fan. Both my parents went to K-State. That's where they met. I never really got into the Royals until I was about in middle school, and they were pretty bad back in those years. But I really started following them when they got Zach Greinke. And that was probably the first time in my lifetime, I had seen a Royals player put on the cover of Sports Illustrated, probably since like Bo Jackson or George Brett, at least to my knowledge. But so that was when I really started being a Royals fan. And then, of course, I'll get into this a little bit later, more depth in future sessions, but that's when, over the years through high school and college, the Royals gradually started to get better. So I've been very thankful and blessed to be able to witness a Royals World Series championship and then a Chiefs Super Bowl championship in my lifetime. And from the time I was real little, that's all I dreamed of, was seeing the Chiefs in the Super Bowl and be able to win a Super Bowl. And then, you know, same with Kansas State football and basketball. I mean, there have been some great runs, some Big 12 championships, you know, some March Madness tournament runs, some high-profile bowl games. But unfortunately, K-State hasn't, you know, been able to, you know, eclipse a national championship in either throughout their history, but they've come, you know, fairly close at times, pretty close. But, you know, I just remember watching K-State football when I was little. Probably the most favorite game I can remember as a kid was the 2003 Big 12 championship with L. Roberson and Darren Sproles and just that defense. And I think the love and the joy that I get from watching Kansas State, even though I didn't actually go there, I applied and got accepted. I got in, but I didn't go just because it was too far away from the East Coast for me. But, you know, seeing the joy of my parents and watching their alma mater was really special and a huge connection back to the state of Kansas and the Kansas City area, where we have a lot of family and friends still. So really overall, being a Kansas City native and identifying with Kansas City, although I didn't actually grow up there, having gone back to visit family and friends really every summer of my childhood has really kept my ties and my connection really deep in my roots and my heart to Kansas City. It's really where I call home, and what I like to say is my favorite place on earth. Out of all the places I've traveled all over the country and worldwide, Kansas City is definitely, will always have a place in my heart. I'm a bit of a crazed Kansas City fanatic, actually. I mean, from the time I wake up to the time I go to sleep, there's not a day that passes by that I don't think about the Chiefs or the Royals or K-State. You know, when's the next game on? What's up? What's the latest news with players, coaches, you know, just the team in general? You know, just even just envisioning greatness really from my favorite teams. Even when I play Madden, or when I used to play NCAA football and basketball, you know, on PlayStation, or, you know, that I'm always thinking about Kansas City sports and my favorite teams. It's just ingrained in my mind. That's really how I kind of live my life, is that's really a passion of mine. You know, some people are passionate about food or, you know, travel, fashion, whatever. But for me, I mean, it's really Kansas City and sports as a whole. I love it, and I can never get enough of it. So it's a big pride thing for me. So going off of that, you know, background, and I'll kind of touch on that as I continue on with my podcast, but, you know, I really want to talk about the Chiefs today and focus on their preparation for the Super Bowl, the Run It Back tour, and really just where my mind's at as a fan and how I can probably relate to most Chiefs fans out there, just with this, how this whole season has gone from the pandemic to the pressure of, you know, a potential Super Bowl hangover and having to, you know, run it back and having every team out there really gunning for you. As a Chiefs fan, I'll say this first. I could not be more proud of the Chiefs, of all of the players and coaches, really the entire team, the staff, the organization, the fan base, Chiefs Kingdom, just, you know, how supportive and how everyone's really rallied together. It's just been amazing to see, especially having grown up, you know, pretty much only seeing the Chiefs, I would say from the time I was real small, real young, to even through college and my first couple of years outside of after college, you know, I never even saw the Chiefs win a playoff game until I think it was 2015. So, you know, it's just been a wild ride. I'm very blessed. I definitely don't take these years, these games, the last 2-3 years for granted, because of how I would say 2013 to 2015, 2016 Royals, that era went. You know, the 2014 playoff run, the drastic improvements they made in 2013, winning it in 2015, and then, you know, phasing out in 2016. It really takes a lot to keep a championship team together. So the way the Chiefs have been able to do it, you know, I'm really hoping they can keep it up for years to come. Just as I'm hoping the Royals can get back there, you know, hopefully one day soon. So, you know, that's where I want to start this podcast off. You know, really just talking about the Chiefs and thinking about the Super Bowl right now. So let's go ahead and get started, really dive in here. I know I've kind of rambled off for about 12 minutes now, giving some background and some context here to the purpose of the podcast, who I am, where I come from, you know, why I want to talk about what it is I'm going to talk about. So let's talk about the Chiefs. You know, it's what today is Wednesday, February 3rd. The Super Bowl is in 4 days. I'm going to be going back home to Philadelphia to watch with my mom and my wife, Genevieve. And, you know, we'll watch with probably my brother, my sister-in-law, my niece, and my mom's dog for, you know, the majority. I think my brother and sister-in-law, since they have, you know, a baby girl who's still only a couple years old, you know, they're definitely going to have to head out sooner rather than later, as a, you know, opposed to keeping my niece up super late. So they might only be able to watch the first half or so. But all in all, I'm excited to watch with my family for a second straight year. For last year's Super Bowl, I watched back home in Philadelphia with my dad and my stepmom, and they had some friends over, and I had a couple of my high school friends over. And man, last year's Super Bowl, I was nervous as hell. I had probably more jitters than I think some of the players. I was scared. I mean, not scared that the Chiefs couldn't do it, but I just couldn't believe they were still, I still couldn't believe they even made it to the Super Bowl. I couldn't believe that we were there. I just was excited. I, as much as I wanted to win, I was just thankful to be there. If it wasn't meant to be, you know, I was ready to accept that and face that, but I really, really wanted to see them win. I was just nervous. Like, I had never been in the position to actually watch my team and care before. In years past, every year of my life leading up to this point, I mean, it's always someone else's team. I had never had a dog in the fight, as they say. So it was hard for me to really care. I could eat and enjoy the game. Last year, I don't think I barely ate a thing all game until after the game was over. I just kept drinking and just, you know, was just praying the whole time. But it was a wild ride. And last year was just an unbelievable year. And really, I think the first 2 years of Mahomes being a starter have just been a wild ride, just an amazing ride. You know, I say this to everyone when I talk about Mahomes, and, you know, I'll touch on this a number of times throughout this session and really the podcast in general. I mean, I'm a huge Mahomes fan and supporter. I could tell Mahomes was special when I first saw him start in his first game as a starter, his rookie year. It was 2017. It was the final game of the regular season. The Chiefs had already locked in their playoff spot. So they rested Alex Smith, and Mahomes got the start at Denver. It was cold. There was a little bit of snow on the ground from what I remember. And, you know, Mahomes, he just gunned it out. I mean, he just was not afraid to make throws. I remember, I think he had at least one interception. He had some overthrows, but he just kept firing. And I think the very first throw that he completed, because I think his first and second down throws were incomplete, but his third down throw to, I think it was Demetrius Harris for like 15, 20, 25 yards on a third and long, like a third and 10 or third and nine, something like that. I mean, I didn't see that coming. I don't think anyone saw that coming. I didn't even really know much about Mahomes up until that point. You know, I didn't really know a whole lot about him in college, even though he was Big 12 also. He played at Texas Tech. I just had not, I don't think I really saw many games that he played. The only thing that I really knew was that he got kind of a negative reputation for being a gunslinger and a risk taker, a bit reckless. A lot of Brett Favre in him is what people, you know, kind of compared him to. But that game against Denver, just seeing the way that he really led the team as a, you know, kind of a redshirt freshman in the pros, so to speak, and how he was able to lead that, you know, take that team during that game, really a lot of the backups, build a lead. They actually ended up taking him out, and they put the third string quarterback in. And that guy, I don't even remember who it was, lost the lead for the Chiefs. And then they put Mahomes back in, and he took us down and regained the lead and won us the game. So seeing that, you know, it was pretty special. It's like, wow, we have a lot of potential and a bright future with this kid. you know, eventually after Alex Smith's time, and he had a lot of pressure on him that year. And, you know, God bless Alex Smith. I'll just make a side note. I'm a big Alex Smith fan as well. I always liked him when he was in Kansas City and playing for us. You know, unfortunately, it just didn't work out. But I'm really glad to see that he came back this year. And I've been saying this since the beginning of the season. He deserves to win Comeback Player of the Year unanimously by far. But, you know, I think that he did a really good job at being a mentor to Mahomes and teaching him. You know, Mahomes just really out of the gates in 2018, that very first touchdown to Tyreek Hill, just that quick slant route over the middle, just really from that Denver game to how the Chiefs got off to a bang in 2018 and just had an incredible season. Yes, the defense was definitely an issue that year, and was part of the reason why we did lose some games. But seeing that just buildup of an explosive offense from what we went through with Smith, I think it was like 2015 to 2017 or 2014 to 2017, I think, to then that transition to Mahomes, really as a second-year, a first-year starter, second-year player. I mean, Mahomes really took the Chiefs in 2018 and built up the foundation. And just being able to see how they were able to win a playoff game. They battled back in that AFC Championship game. And unfortunately, as much as I hate seeing Tom Brady win in general and seeing the Chiefs lose to Brady once again, you know, that really paved the way for things to come. Because, you know, then last year in our Super Bowl winning campaign, I mean, we beat Brady in New England. You know, we go on that wild playoff run. And I'll say this again, like another reason I knew Mahomes was special, and really when I was able to tell that this team was special, and I think all of Kansas City Chiefs Kingdom, the whole fan base could really tell we've got a special nucleus, a dynamic, is the Chiefs' ability to overcome all the deficits from the playoffs last year, every single game. Houston, Tennessee, and San Francisco. I mean, that 24-0 deficit at home against Houston in the divisional round, I didn't even know what to think. I was watching when my wife and I were living with my mother-in-law at her house. We were watching with my brother-in-law and sister-in-law. And I just remember, I just kept drinking beers like one after another. I didn't get mad. I didn't even really get vocal. I was kind of shaking my head a little bit after the muffed punt return by Tyreek Hill, the drop passes by, you know, Kelsey, D-Rob, Damian Williams, just seeing the Chiefs really just not in sync and just, you know, really just getting down early and really not playing like themselves. I could tell something was wrong, but I knew that we were not, in the back of my mind, I knew that we were not really out of it. I had seen the Chiefs a couple years prior play in the week one, you know, opening weekend game against the Chargers, and we were down like 24-3 or something like that in the third quarter. And then Smith throws a bubble screen out to Tyreek Hill. He runs it into the end zone, and that really kickstarts the fire. And then we came back and won that game in overtime. You know, that right there, I knew that this Chiefs team under Andy Reid, you know, with the players that he had, with Kelsey, with Tyreek, with all these guys that really came together, this team is special. They're capable of something. So after that comeback against Houston and then really just blowing them out after that, I mean, we didn't just come back, we blew them out. Then on to Tennessee, and we, you know, down 10 points, oh, it's nothing. San Francisco in the Super Bowl, what, 6-7 minutes left? Same thing, down 10. I mean, down 10 or 11 points. This Chiefs team, and especially with the leadership of Mahomes and the trust that he has from Andy Reid and Eric Bieniemy, I mean, this team is just not out of it. They're never out of it. I tell my mom and my dad this all the time. I mean, Mahomes, under Mahomes, the Chiefs have yet to lose a game by more than 8 points. They lost to the Raiders this year by 8 points. And that, I think, is probably the worst deficit from a margin standpoint from you know, how many points, how many digits did you lose by? Because I think in 2018 they lost to the Seahawks and the Patriots by 7, I believe. And those games, especially Seattle, you know, those games they were kind of trailing. It felt like, ah, you know, this just might not be their day, but they kept it close. Mahomes just won't let this team lose by 2-3 touchdowns. It's just not going to happen. Even when they have bad days, they eventually figure it out. You can't keep them down for 4 quarters. People say that week in and week out. So all that is really to say, you know, I think this year is just another representation that this Chiefs team is still special. They continue to be special, and they continue to build on the foundation that they've set. They got a lot of flack last year after they won the Super Bowl for claiming themselves to be a dynasty or the next dynasty. I think what they really meant to say was that, you know, our mission is to build a dynasty, and it starts here. It starts with winning that first championship. It starts with determining your goals to run it back. We're going to be here again. We're going to have this Super Bowl parade again. So plan on it. Don't just think that this is one and done. There was no Super Bowl hangover. There has not been any regression. They've been criticized all year long for not impressing people, you know, certain people like Skip Bayless, Stephen A. Smith. You know, people are skeptical and critical of the fact that they have not, you know, they have not blown some teams out where they should have. They've managed to escape narrow margins against, you know, certain teams. Well, you know what? That was kind of the similar case in the playoffs. And in the NFL, a win's a win. It's not like college. You don't need style points and, you know, points on in the polls and computer rankings. The Chiefs have done what they needed to do to find ways to win. Not every Sunday is going to be the same. You're not going to play up to par. You're not going to play the same way every single game and maintain that consistency just throughout. There's adversity. There's ups and downs. And this team understands that. And that's really what's incredible to me. And that's why I think as a fan, I'm able to sit back a little bit more these days and just watch. Just enjoy, embrace, and just appreciate the downs as well as the ups. I think starting in 2018, I really shifted and adjusted my mindset, my perspective, my approach to being a fan. Because I would say really my entire life leading up to 2018, I was so frustrated with seeing us lose playoff games, let alone the seasons when we did not make the playoffs or we had losing records. You know, those years were always frustrating. Like, oh man, I want to see my team in the playoffs. You know, that's how I would think when I was a little kid. And, you know, when they finally got their first playoff win against Houston, I think it was 2015. And, you know, that game, I mean, Houston just didn't even really play well. That was when they had Brian Hoyer at quarterback, and he threw like 4 picks the whole game. But, you know, essentially, I mean, up until that point, I hadn't even seen a playoff win. The first playoff win in my lifetime when I was too young to ever remember, I think, was 93 with Joe Montana. But you know, when they finally won that playoff game, it's like, okay, I got a taste of a playoff win. Now I want more, you know? And they weren't able to win that following week at New England. In years to come, I wanted to see us get back to the playoffs and make a run. We would end up losing a game to the Steelers in the playoffs at home in the wild card round. We'd lose, we lost the wild card round game at Arrowhead against the Tennessee. That's when Kelsey got hurt with a concussion. We were up 21-3 at halftime and let them come back in the second half to win 22-21. So, you know, up to that point, I was just kind of fed up and honestly spoiled as a fan. It's like, you know what? It's a hard job that these guys do going out there to play football professionally, the coaches, everything they do, you know, the organization to make those right decisions with drafting, trading players and how they build and coach players. But the next year, you know, in 2018, I went into that regular season just telling myself, you know what, just sit back in your chair as you watch the game, you know, downstairs, in front of the TV, just sit back, relax. Don't be so tense when, you know, the Chiefs are on defense, and I tend to tighten up my leg or I kind of clench my fist or my foot when I'm seeing a run play from the other team and they're gaining, you know, 5, 6, 7, 8 yards, 10, 15 yards more. I'm like, stop them. But you know what? I have no control over it. And it took me years to really figure that out. And I don't even have it as bad as like my uncle or family members, you know, friends that are a lot older than me who have seen, you know, the drought for practically the entire history of the franchise since they won the first Super Bowl in 69. So I readjusted my expectations. I just chose to embrace what was going on, let it happen, and just what happens, happens. And thankfully, you know, God blessed me and God blessed the Chiefs in Kansas City with just a great team. The Chiefs have just been so exciting the past 2 years now, you know, now 3 years. You know, everything that they did in 2018 and everything they did in last year in 2019 to get better and take it all the way, win the AFC Championship, and, you know, get the Lamar Hunt Trophy and then go on and win the Super Bowl. I mean, I just couldn't be happier. I cannot believe that we're back here in the Super Bowl for the second year in a row. Run it back has been the mantra. I love using that hashtag. And I'm just so excited for the Super Bowl. You know, whatever's meant to happen is meant to happen, just like last year. Hopefully, it's another Super Bowl win. I'm confident we can win. Absolutely, 100%, 200%. But I'm not overly cocky about it. You know, the way the Super Bowl works is it's just like any other Sunday. You know, you could show up or you could not show up. Sometimes things happen that are just out of your control. In the Super Bowl, in the biggest of moments, the biggest of games, you know, the be-all, end-all of football, the big one, there are some crazy things that can happen that people just can't explain. It's happened, you know, in years past, countless number of times. Everything from the, you know, the David Tyree catch on the helmet to Julian Edelman, you know, catching it after it bounced on, you know, a dude's leg when there's like 3 or 4 guys piled up. I mean, there have just been crazy things that have happened in Super Bowls. Just last year, I mean, that 3rd and 15 that Mahomes threw to the, you know, the wasp play to Tyreek, I just, my heart just sunk when that ball went up. I could not believe it. But at the same time, I shouldn't be surprised. And I tell myself that all the time, that the Chiefs are just that good. And people continue to underestimate them and, you know, try to take things away from their success. But they are extremely talented. I really think that the Chiefs are the most talented team I've ever seen, and especially on offense, the most talented offensive unit I've ever seen in football, period. And I know that sounds 100%, you know, that sounds and comes off completely biased, and it is. I'm a Chiefs fan. I'm going to say that. And of course, I'm going to be biased, but I'm not even joking. I mean, there have been some other teams and players in years past. I mean, I give all the credit to the world to a guy like Peyton Manning, and you know, you look at one of the best, probably the best running quarterback ever, Mike Vick. There are players out there that have just been at the top of the game, just the best, you know, at their position. Some teams that have just been, you know, like you look at the, what was it, the 2001 Ravens that won the Super Bowl and the 85 Bears. I mean, those are, you know, the best defenses of all time. But I have to say, this Chiefs offense, it starts with Mahomes. I mean, that dude, his arm talent is crazy. People love to compare and say, oh, Josh Allen throws harder. No, no way. Mahomes can throw harder and farther. And he also can throw it like a baseball. I mean, it's just unreal how he can sidearm and do no-look passes. I wouldn't be surprised if one day he literally tosses it behind his back and completes it. You know, he's throwing it left-handed. He's just extremely creative and innovative. You just can't teach that. And you know, how he's able to throw across his body, running, moving left, and throw right. These things you just can't explain. It starts with him. And then from there, it's the speed. I mean, Tyreek Hill, Mecole Hardman, when we had Damian Williams, still with Sammy Watkins, you've just got dudes that are just so freaking fast. Byron Pringle, D-Rob, I mean, they are the Legion of Zoom. They have so much speed all over the field, you cannot cover them all. And to top it all off, I mean, we already had the best tight end, in my opinion, in NFL history, in Tony Gonzalez, and we got another one, Travis Kelce. I mean, you have a great tight end matched with great wide receivers and then a plethora of running backs. You know, it was unfortunate to see Damian Williams opt out, but he did what he needed to do, just like Laurent Duvernay-Tardif did and some other players. But we didn't miss a beat. You know, we brought in Clyde Edwards-Helaire. We still have Darrell Williams. We've even got Darwin Thompson, you know, waiting for his time to come up. We added Le'Veon Bell. I mean, even last year when we had Shady McCoy, the Chiefs are just loaded. And then don't even get me started about the defense. The defense this year, they have just, over the past couple of years, they've really brought in talent. They've molded guys together. They've had a solid foundation with the guys up front like Chris Jones, Derek Nnadi. You know, you add Frank Clark, the Shark, on the edge. You've got other guys mixed in, and you know, the linebacking core is solid. The secondary really got secured and tightened up with Tyrann Mathieu. I mean, this is just Brett Veach, Andy Reid, this whole organization, you know, keeping Eric Bieniemy, Coach Spax. I could go on and on and on, but they're just, as a unit, they've really come together, tied all the pieces together in the puzzle, and they're just a solid unit. And so the sky's the limit. I mean, the past couple of years, they used phrases in interviews like they were just scratching the surface. And I fully believe that. I think there's a lot of greatness yet to come that we can't even fathom, that we've yet to see, that's going to come from this team. And I wouldn't be surprised if this is the next dynasty on the rise. And I would love that. I would love to see the Chiefs during Mahomes' career go out and win like freaking 7 Super Bowls. I mean, that's the dream, to get more Super Bowls than any other franchise out there, to surpass New England, surpass Pittsburgh. But, you know, worst case scenario, even if the Chiefs only win a handful with Mahomes, I mean, that's still more than I could ever ask for in my lifetime. So, you know, going off of that, just to kind of, you know, recap, I guess, the playoff run, because, you know, stemming from the regular season this past year, I mean, what a hell of a regular season. There were a number of times that the Chiefs could have and probably should have lost, but they escaped with a win, and that's what the good teams are able to do. Back in the day when the Chiefs were not as good as, you know, the top dogs in the league, the Chiefs were able to hang with them, play with them, compete, get an edge on them. But if they couldn't close the game, the other team pulled away. And that was, you know, Peyton Manning's Colts. That was Brady and the Patriots. That was Big Ben and the Steelers. That was Rivers and the Chargers. You know, that was the Broncos back in the day. They would have our number two. The Chiefs are able to find a way to win. You know, they essentially went 14-1 this year. I don't count the last game of the regular season. That was, you know, just a rest day, you know, a bye week for the starters, let the backups play. You know, the game didn't matter at all. So this team essentially lost one game this year. And really, the Chiefs, in my opinion, are still the top of the AFC West, easily, by far. The Chiefs are a better team than the Raiders, just like they are than the Chargers and the Broncos. The Chiefs lost to the Raiders because the Chiefs did not show up, and the Raiders did. The Chiefs did not, you know, come out and start fast. They didn't play well. They were not in sync and on the same page. And the Raiders were. You know, you got to give them credit. As much as I freaking hate the Raiders, you know, we've been beating the entire AFC West for the last, you know, several years now at a crazy rate that I just can't even fathom. I mean, I went my entire life just seeing the Chiefs pretty much lose to all the AFC West opponents. It seemed like we would either get swept every season or we would lose one of two. We would win at home, we would lose to them on the road. So the Chiefs have been dominant in their division, and that's been crucial. That has been key. So, you know, it starts there, and this season was another reflection of that. You know, with Mahomes as the starter, this Chiefs team has only lost 5 regular season games. They lost 4 last year, or 4 2 years ago, and they lost 1. Or 4 last year and 1 this past year. So only 5 regular season games. And so going from there, I mean, a solid regular season. They did what they set out to do. The next goal was, you know, after making the playoffs, after wrapping up the division, getting the number one seed, It's then, you know, win the AFC Championship game, make it back to the conference championship, win and get the Lamar Hunt Trophy back and keep it in Kansas City. And they did that. I mean, starting with the divisional game against Cleveland, man, oh man. I mean, that was a roller coaster. I watched that with my mom and my sister. They visited my wife and I, and we watched in our apartment. And we, I mean, there's no wonder my apartment complex got a noise reminder email sent out to everyone in the complex. It was probably because of us. you know, that game was crazy. It was really tough seeing Patrick Mahomes go down with that, you know, injury, potential concussion. But he's one tough dude. I mean, I've seen Mahomes battle through ankle and leg injuries during a game, you know, get banged up, pushed through. It was really tough seeing him last year go out with that knee injury in the Denver game on the road and just wondering, man, like, is he going to be back? And thankfully he was, and it really didn't take a whole lot of time for him to heal up and come back. This year's playoffs, similar deal. I mean, it was tough to see him, you know, potentially almost get concussed and go, you know, deal with that turf toe and just be hit the way that he was and have it just be a scary moment like that. And with, you know, almost half the game left, just think, man, can we keep it together and win with Chad Henne and escape this game with a win and move on and hopefully give ourselves a chance to, you know, play to get to another Super Bowl. And we did. Hashtag anything is possible. I mean, I will believe that till the day I die, because Chad Henne coming in as the backup quarterback, the, you know, a true veteran. I mean, he showed some guts with that third and long diving extension to try to get the first down. And then the gutsy call by Big Red and Eric Bieniemy to go for it on fourth down, go for the win, play like there's no tomorrow. Just outstanding. I mean, my family and I, we went nuts. It was crazy. It was just a great first win. It was scary to watch, but it was a good playoff win to move on to the next round. It was really, all in all, a great performance by the whole team, just stepping up, doing their jobs, filling their roles, the defense stepping up big time. And there's nothing better than seeing the Chiefs beat Baker Mayfield and the Browns, because one thing I cannot stand over the last couple of years is Baker Mayfield in the NFL and how people continue to overhype the Browns. You know, I'm happy just as much as any other fan is neutrally for the Browns after, you know, their franchise going years and years without having success. But with Baker Mayfield and Odell Beckham Jr., I'm not a fan of those guys. As much as OBJ is talented, he's extremely cocky and arrogant and is extremely frustrating to really watch with his antics on the field, his behavior off the field. I also think Baker Mayfield is overrated. He's a huge show-off, and I really don't think he's going to be relevant in the next 3 to 5 years at most. I mean, that's generous. I would say in 2 years, we're really going to see whether this guy is a starter long-term or if he's going to fade out and be a backup like RG3. Because Baker Mayfield, I don't care that he won the Heisman Trophy. He's just another Oklahoma quarterback coming into the league, thinking he's, you know, hot stuff, all that. His game's not going to translate to the pros. He tries to compete with Mahomes and make throws like he does, he can't do it. So seeing the Chiefs beat Baker Mayfield and the Browns, I mean, that was awesome. You know, we beat them 2 years ago, but to beat them in the playoffs when it really counts, especially with people hyping up the Browns after, you know, after they won at Pittsburgh. I mean, look, I knew Pittsburgh was overrated this year from the start. Big Ben coming back, you know, them starting off, what, like 11-0, and then they lose 3 in a row. That is a classic formula for hot start, but not really meant to last the distance. The Chiefs have been there before. I've seen the Chiefs start 9-0 twice in my lifetime. It happened in 2013 and it happened in 2003. And speaking of 2003, just going back to my point about this Chiefs team especially on offense, this being the best offensive unit ever in football, period. In the NFL, and I mean, if you want to compare it to college, it's not a fair comparison, but better than any of those high-powered college offenses that, you know, like Oregon used to put up, what, like 60, 70 points a game? This Chiefs team can pass. They can throw on anybody. They don't run the ball the best necessarily, but they don't really need to. Now, it's good when they can have the running game run the clock and tire out the defense, especially when they need to. But at any moment in time, this Chiefs team can just bomb it deep. And teams have learned to protect against that. They're afraid of it. They give Mahomes these 5, 10, 15-yard routes. So the fact that Mahomes can just strike it from anywhere on the field, down the middle, you know, down the hashes, up the seams, those quick out routes, those hitch routes, you know, hit Kelsey in the flat and him run it 5 to 6, 7, 8 yards. I mean, the bubble screens, the end around jet sweeps. This team, their air attack is unmatched. I would argue against anyone who wants to say that there's a better passing scheme out there in all of NFL history. I'm gonna argue that against any of Peyton Manning's teams, any of Tom Brady's teams. Mahomes and his receivers, and it almost doesn't even matter who's on the offensive line. They've been so banged up. They're going into the Super Bowl banged up, having lost Eric Fisher, God bless his soul, with the Achilles injury. They have so many other offensive linemen who have been banged up or are hurt, and they've had backups come in and replace them. We don't even have Laurent Duvernay-Tardif because he opted out of the season. It doesn't matter. Mahomes is able to get the ball out so quickly. Big Red and Eric Bieniemy scheme and have a great strategy at getting the ball out quickly, mixing it up with the run and the pass, mixing it up with their personnel. You know, they'll bring in Byron Pringle. They'll bring in D-Rob. Even without Sammy Watkins, other guys step up. They can even hit their, you know, they can hit Anthony Sherman. They could hit backup Travis. I'm blanking on our backup tight end's name right now, but you know, they can hit him too, just like they did Demetrius Harrison last couple years. You know, so even last year with Blake Bell, they are just able to mix and match all their personnel. You can double cover Tyreek. You can double cover Kelsey. But guess what? Mecole Hardman's going to be open. Oh, how'd you forget about him? He's like the second fastest player on the field. Same thing goes with the other guys. I mean, this team, they've just got so many people to work with. I posted a picture that I kind of customized in Photoshop on my Instagram about a year ago. And the caption of it was, can you cover them all? And I put like all, I mean, it was freaking like 10, 11 or 12 dudes on the Chiefs, from Kelsey to Hill to Mecole Hardman to literally every single running back, Sammy Watkins. I mean, Mahomes has options beyond belief. So this is the best offense out there ever. I don't know if there's ever going to be an offense like this that's ever going to be this good. Seriously. The best Chiefs offense I've seen before this team right now was probably the 2003 Chiefs, because they could run the ball like nobody's business. I've never seen a team able to run that well. People these days love to say that Derrick Henry is a future Hall of Famer and that Tennessee running attack is just phenomenal. And it is. It's good. It's very good. He's a big, big running back, stocky guy that is just extremely hard to bring down. But with that said, I still don't think anyone has ever run the ball as well as the 2003 Chiefs. I mean, you had a stacked offensive line that just bowled people over. They were able to pull their tackles and guards and do these pitch sweeps that, like, those kind of plays don't even work in the NFL anymore. I mean, you had center Casey Wegman, you had Brian Waters, you had Willie Rofe, Will Shields. This offensive line just, they got such an amazing push that you just could not get through that line. You had Tony Gonzalez blocking, best blocking tight end ever. And that's why, as good as Travis Kelce is, and all due respect to Travis Kelce, I love Travis Kelce, huge, huge fan. But that is one thing that Tony Gonzalez has about him that, and I can tell Travis Kelce is continuously trying to improve, but Tony Gonzalez could block. I mean, he didn't just catch and, you know, require three guys to bring him down, but I mean, he could block. And then you add Tony Richardson as your fullback, a former running back on the Chiefs, and then you give the ball to Priest Holmes. Trent Green fit perfectly within that offense because the Chiefs were able to run so well between 01, 02, 03 to 04 before Priest Holmes got hurt and Larry Johnson came in, who also was a phenomenal rusher for us. The only problem with the 03 Chiefs was this. As good as they were able to run, they just couldn't pass as well. Their play calling scheme was too predictable. It was always run, run, pass. It was run on first down, run on second down, and then pass on third down with the hopes that you were either going to pick up the first down on first down or second down, or you would at least make it into a manageable third and short down. So when it ended up being, you know, third and 10, third and 8, third and 9, third and 12, third and 15, you get a holding penalty, whatever, block in the back. Defenses knew the Chiefs were going to pass it. And that's the difference. This Chiefs offense might not run nearly as well as that Chiefs offense did in 03, but this Chiefs offense can pass. It doesn't matter what the yardage is on third down. It doesn't matter if it's fourth down. If it's fourth and two, and the Chiefs go for it, the Chiefs can get it. They don't always necessarily get it, but I would say 9 times out of 10, they can get it. I would say 10 times out of 10, they can get it. Sometimes they get a little too cute. Against the, gosh, who was it? I can't remember if it was the Panthers or, I think it was the Falcons. It was the Falcons this year. On a fourth and short, instead of just doing a run play up the middle, which is a lot of times what I scream at the TV these days. I know I said I've told myself to relax and just enjoy the show, embrace what's going on. But sometimes I wish that they would just, you know, plug it up the middle. You know, hand it off to Le'Veon or Darrell Williams and just punch it up the middle. 1-2 yard gain, or if it's inches, you know, just get it up the middle. Against the Falcons, they did a double reverse flea flicker pitch, and Sammy Watkins threw it to Mahomes, ended up getting picked off. You know, they only had like a yard to go. They didn't need to run that kind of a play. But we've seen a number of times, just like Chad Henne was able to hit Tyreek on that quick flat route. You know, they stack the trips wide on the right, and they get Kelce and the third receiver going deep. And there's all this attention going deep down the field. Well, Tyreek is so quick off the line of scrimmage, he's able to just sneak out the side and you hit him really quick. That's a play that they can run over and over and over again, and you're just not going to be able to stop it. So, really quick, going to wrap up here soon. We're approaching almost an hour. I want to try to keep my sessions within under an hour. But, gosh, I mean, the Bills game, the AFC Conference Championship game. I mean, what a win. What an awesome consecutive conference championship win, and this run of 3 years now where Kansas City has hosted the AFC Conference Championship game 3 years in a row. I can't believe it. The Bills game was tough. You know, especially starting off, I was like, oh, here we go again. I'm ready. You know, go down 10-0. I wasn't even mad at Mecole Hardman. You know, I was like, muff the punt. But you know what? He knows what he did. The team was picking him right back up. Like, hey, you know, keep your head up. Don't get down on yourself. Don't beat yourself up. We've been here before. We know who we are. Let's do us, you know, be us. That's what Mahomes said. Kelce, our coaches were going over to Mecole and picking him back up. Like, there's a lot of game to be played. We've not only been there before, but that was nothing. Down 10 points. I mean, gosh, 24-0 was like, holy crap, you know? So, I mean, the conference championship, the AFC championship win over the Bills was awesome. You know, it was a tough game. Buffalo's a great team, tough team. I give them a lot of credit. I had a lot of respect for them up until the end when they started picking a fight with us. I mean, of course, I'm biased. I'm going to say it that way. But look, Josh Allen, you know, with that classless act, and this is why I don't respect him, you know, beyond people just saying, oh, he has a stronger arm than Mahomes and he can throw farther and harder than Mahomes, and that's bull. That's BS. You know, the Bills, I lost a lot of respect for them when Josh Allen threw that ball at, I can't even remember whose face mask that was, but on the Chiefs defense, just throwing the ball at his face mask, you know, after he got a clean sack, and then the Bills offensive line coming over and just attacking, not once, but twice, three times, clenching his fist, throwing a punch. It aggravated me to no end when the refs also called a penalty on us. I mean, there should have been ejections. I hope there were fines on the Bills for that. They were sore losers. I waved at the TV and I said, you know what? Have a nice freaking trip back to Buffalo, because that was classless, poor sportsmanship. They're just pissed because the Chiefs are better than the Bills. We're going to the Super Bowl. Their Super Bowl-less franchise history is going to continue, and I hope it stays that way. I didn't used to think like that, but now I do. Because you know what? If you're going to play like that, I mean, as much as the Chiefs have lost to the Patriots, we have not pulled crap like that, ever. The Chiefs have always been a class act organization. Sure, we've had issues with Travis Kelce and Marcus Peters, Larry Johnson, and their, you know, immaturity issues. But Travis Kelce has grown a lot. I can't really say the same for Marcus Peters or Larry Johnson. But, gosh, you know, it was surreal winning the AFC Championship game once again. But, you know, I also was telling myself, you know what, I'm gonna enjoy this. This is awesome. I'm excited. I'm happy. But at the same time, I'm not going to, you know, get too excited over this, because the ultimate goal is to win the Super Bowl again. I tend to maintain the same mindset as the Chiefs, as the players, the coaches, everything that they preach in their interviews. Same with Brett Veach and Clark Hunt. The job's not done. You know, the goals have been set really since the end of last season. The goal was to repeat, to run it back. And to fall short of that is seen as a failure. If the Chiefs had lost their first game to Cleveland, this season would have been for nothing. If we hadn't won the AFC Championship game, we would have fallen short big time. We got back. We're going back. We're here. The time is now. And really, this time is Kansas City's time. Brady's time is over. I think Brady has gotten extremely lucky going to Tampa Bay and getting an opportunity to play for in a Super Bowl. You know, last year I would say the nation was pretty split. Who are you rooting for? If you're neutral and you're not a Chiefs fan or a 49ers fan, I'd say it was half and half. This year, most people are going to be rooting for Kansas City, because no one wants to see Tom frickin' Brady, Tampa Bay, win another Super Bowl. He's, like Mahomes said, he's playing in like his 150th Super Bowl. I mean, this guy needs to retire. I'm sick and tired of Brady. The refs always make calls in his favor. All he does is complain because he can't take hits. I want to see him get nailed this game. In the playoffs, they tend to let plays go a little bit more, a little bit rougher play, more aggression. You know, they let guys hit a little bit more unless it's, you know, really over the line. And they don't call as many flags. I hope Brady throws 5 interceptions and hope 3 of them are pick sixes. I was talking with my dad about this. Usually in the Super Bowl, especially if you don't have a team playing in it, you don't really want to see a blowout. You want to see a good game. You want to see a close game. But this is one of the few exceptions where, I mean, I hope the Chiefs kill the Bucs. I mean, I hope the Chiefs kill every team. Like, I would love it if the Chiefs just won every week, you know, 56-0. But it doesn't happen like that. But the Super Bowl, anything can happen. Any team could just absolutely have a bad day. And maybe that's going to happen to Brady and the Bucs. Now, I'm not one to really look at trends and history too too deeply. But I will say that every Super Bowl Brady has been in, you know, whether he's won or lost, it's been relatively close. There hasn't really been, you know, a Super Bowl where, you know, I think where it was pretty definitive that he lost was his last Super Bowl loss with the Patriots to the Eagles. You know, when he and the Pats beat the Rams, you know, that was a very boring game. It was only a 10-point difference. But aside from those, it's been relatively close. So, you know, it's definitely possible that Brady and the Bucks, you know, if they do lose, that it's close. If they win, I think it'll be close. But I also fully believe the Chiefs have what it takes to just blow the Bucks out of the water. I mean, not that this matters, but when we played the Bucks earlier this year in the regular season, I mean, we were dominating them early on. Up until Mahomes got strip sacked when we were in the red zone, we were dominating them on every play, every down, offense and defense. Brady and the Bucks could hardly even get a first down. If we would have just kept up that momentum, kept the foot on the gas and gone up like 28-0, I think we could have blown them out. And so that's what needs to happen this Sunday. Now, if it is a back and forth battle, Brady versus Mahomes type of thing, I fully believe the Chiefs can win as well. The Chiefs have shown their toughness and their ability to overcome adversity and their tenacity to hang with any team. You know, the past 2 years, the Chiefs were on the rise and they were still overlooked by the Patriots and, you know, some teams in the NFC and one or two other teams in the AFC, I would say. There's been a lot of comparison that, oh, the Ravens are the more complete team. Well, again, I say BS to that because the Chiefs and Mahomes have, with Mahomes, the Chiefs have yet to lose to Lamar and the Ravens. The Chiefs dominate the AFC West. You know, sure, the Chiefs in 2018 lost to the Seahawks and the Rams, but those were tough, close games, and I fully believe that next time the Chiefs play those teams, I believe Mahomes and the Chiefs can beat them. I mean, Mahomes and the Chiefs showed up big time against the Saints and beat Drew Brees. You know, they didn't even let Brees complete hardly a pass, like, until the second quarter, from what I remember from that game. So, I'm really looking forward to this Sunday. I'm not that nervous yet. I'm sure I'll be getting pretty nervous soon. Usually around the weekend and definitely game day, I'm going to be pretty jittery. I couldn't really eat much during normal meal times for the Browns and the Bills games. But overall, I'm just telling myself to enjoy the ride, embrace these times and these feelings for what they are, because you never know if something happens and, you know, this could be the best Chiefs run ever. And maybe it all ends, you know, after this season. I don't like to think that way, but you just never know. So the key is to not take things for granted as a Chiefs fan, to just pray to God, you know, believe, be confident, feel positive about Patrick Mahomes and his ability. Coach Andy Reid, Eric Bieniemy, Coach Spags, Coach Dave Tube, like all the entire coaching staff with Mahomes and these play callers, they know what they're doing. The entire offense, the defense, the front office, the entire organization, this franchise, and all of Chiefs Kingdom. I mean, this is for Kansas City. I've been telling my wife for the past 3 years, ever since Mahomes really became the starter for the Chiefs, I believe, and I believed before they won the Super Bowl, that Mahomes could have been, and he is, the savior to the city. He is the savior that was sent to Kansas City to bring us a championship, to bring greatness, to make us, hopefully, ideally, the next dynasty. And that could really, really start to become a thing and cement itself with a second consecutive Super Bowl and being able to run it back. It would just be absolutely amazing. All in all, before I close out, the last thing I'll say is I'm just still so thankful that I got to see the Chiefs win one Super Bowl in my lifetime. So if I never get to see another one, I'll be just fine with that. Same with the Royals and the World Series. It's not that there's nothing to look forward to in life from here, but I've seen them win it. I've seen them lose plenty of playoff games. It happens. You know, the Chiefs lost the very first Super Bowl in Super Bowl history to the Packers, Super Bowl I. So the record's 2-1. It's pretty good. Well, plenty of teams that have never even been to a Super Bowl, let alone won one. And there are a lot of teams that have been to a number of Super Bowls, and they've lost more than they've won. So if the Chiefs were able to win the Super Bowl this Sunday, I mean, I would just be over the moon. Like, I wouldn't even know where to start thinking. I mean, that's just, I couldn't have asked for more. Like, I'm just so thankful. Like, I never even dreamed, like, oh, you know, I really want to see the Chiefs win this many Super Bowls in my lifetime. I just wanted to see them win one. So I'm excited. I believe in these guys. I'm going to be going up to Philly, see my family this weekend, watch at my mom's house. I'm looking forward to that. And last year, the theme for food was Kansas City barbecue. My dad smoked some ribs out in his smoker on the patio. This year is going to be more Philly food. I'm going to be eating a cheesesteak from Wawa's, and I'm probably going to get some Philly-style pizza and hot wings. But it's going to be a great game. It's going to be a tough one. But I'm going to enjoy it. I'm going to be rocking my Mahomes jersey and rooting on these boys. And hopefully when I resume this podcast in session number 2 next week, we'll have a lot to recap about on a positive note, and I can come in extremely happy and just praise a nice Super Bowl victory. But if not, you know, we'll cross that bridge when we get there, and it's still been a hell of a season and a hell of a team. But I'm going to be confident, positive, optimistic, and pray and hope for a win, and I feel confident that we can do that. So that's it for session number 1 of my podcast. If you've been listening, thank you so much for tuning in. I'm sorry. I know I rambled quite a bit and said a lot. I've gone a few minutes over 1 hour, but I will continue next week and continue to guide and structure this podcast, really covering all of Kansas City sports, and probably will expand beyond much more than that. But go ahead, and once again, if you're listening, thank you so much for tuning in. Be sure to check out my personal website, my Instagram, and the other videos on my YouTube channel. The links are down below in the description of this video. Excuse me. And tune in next week. That's it. Go Chiefs!
When you're